take that long. First couple of words is about the Mima brand, what Mima stands for. It's a completely new brand, very ambitious. It's a creative brand based out of Spain. The creativity is our central keyword. For everything we do in Mima, it's about creativity. We live, breathe, and eat creativity. Through design and innovation, we try to offer creative product solutions to parents to make their life a little bit easier and a little bit more pleasant. Not only through the products we try to spread creativity, but also through our communication. And I'm very pleased to show you our new campaign. Those are the two examples. Our new campaign is called Explore Mima Imagination. So this is all about creativity. The idea behind this is that children have their minds free of any preconceptions. They're not polluted with boring ideas. So they're open to anything. So I think that children are much more creative than we adults are. We have too many worries, too many problems in our head. So we are saying, from Mima point of view, we invite you to the world of Mima and be as creative and open as children. Children see things that we may not see. They're much more imaginative. So in these photography, we try to show what they might see. This shows a little bit the atmosphere of what we want to do with the Mima brand. It's all about being creative. Now I'll talk a little bit about myself. I hate talking about myself, but they twisted my arm, so. I'm from Holland. I studied industrial design in Holland. And after my studies, I went to Milan, Italy, to start working in a design office. So I feel myself as a Dutch Italian designer. So Dutch being rational, and then Italian is really designing from the heart. So in Italy, I actually learned how to be a designer. It's about the emotional aspects which I learned in Italy. So in all my design work is built around the concept of emotional design. I don't know if you heard about emotional design. For me, design is not about trying to get all kinds of small features into a product. For me, design is about making an emotional connection with the user. Your target consumer has to identify themselves with the product, make them feel proud to use it, make them feel special. And that you can create by using emotional design. Just a couple of examples of my previous work. Here you can see this is it's a normal public payphone, but it's not normal because when you see it, you almost feel the need that you have to make a call. It's so inviting, the shape. It's all soft and friendly, and that's emotional design. This is another public payphone. Already 10, 12 years ago, when mobile phones weren't that used yet. And before this was launched, there was a test here in London. And they put some of these machines also in Oxford Street. And I saw pictures and videos of people using this payphone, and they were actually hugging the phone, just making a call. This is a kitchen timer I did for Lassie. It's like a little animal that becomes a companion of your life, of your kitchen. Very easy to hold in your hand, very intuitive. And these were the last products I did as an external designer. Maybe you've seen these products already. It's the collection. So now we talk a little bit after that episode of my life. I decided to do something else. How did I get to Mima? well, this is my big source of inspiration. These are my two little monsters, which I raised with my wife. So I went through the whole parenthood with all the problems and all the joy that can bring. So I saw the day-to-day problems. And my wife and I, we started making a list of smart ideas, which we thought that could be interesting. Ideas of things that we were missing in the products that we were using. For example, boys have 2 years of difference. This was 10 years ago. And there was no smart solution to transport to children of those age. So that's where this solution was born. Another source of inspiration, when you try to innovate, the trick is not to look at competitors. So don't look at pushchairs. Look at completely different categories, and there you can find new materials, new ideas. So car interiors has been a big source of inspiration. When I was looking at some strollers, the look I hated was these fabric seats. They were all stitched, and they looked wrinkled, and they just gave a very cheap look to me. And when I look at car interiors, I see smooth lines, it's all really well designed, all detailed. And I decided to use this new material, which is EVA, which is used also for suitcases. It's lightweight, and you can shape it in any shape you want. And that gives that smooth and really nice look. Then you look at all the other categories, other than strollers, other than pushchairs. And also architecture is one of my big sources of inspiration. So that brings us to Kobi and Xari. I told already a little bit about a couple of the ideas we had for these. The possibility to transport to babies, the material which we use for the seat. That's about it.
I feel as though I should carry on. It seems to be listening. Important to get right.
Well, as this is the first time I've been doing a pushchair, I did something really, in the eyes of others, maybe strange mechanically. This is a construction which is very challenging. Because here, this is where all the force gets. All the force is concentrated in this piece. So that's why I decided to use strong aluminium to make that strong enough to resist all those forces.
So for the engineers amongst you, there's something to get excited about. This is a piece of polished cast aluminium, and it had to be that way to take the strength. If you think here, you've got the weight of both children suspended through that joint and then coming down into that suspension. But it helps get that really elegant shape and the fold and the compactness of the both frames. Anyway, that's not me, but the seat position is either down here. So this is what I would call kind of coffee table position. So if you're in somewhere like the place to eat upstairs, you can literally push this up to a table, you can just pop the handlebar off, and then your child can stay in there while you're having coffee talking to your mates. And you'll find that is almost exactly the right height for a table. As you can see, it's pretty easy to get the handlebar off. And then when you're out and about pushing along, it's much nicer for the child to be up high. So there's just two positions, because that's all you really need. You want that low position, which allows a baby to be at the sort of height of a table, and then you want a higher position for pushing it around. And I think the important thing about the position changing on this is that it's very quick to do, and you can do it, you know, day to day as you're using the pushchair. This seat can then turn around, so it faces the other way. And again, you know, you'll see here that if you have the seat on the higher position, it's very easy to get at your baby, you're not bending over the whole time. But then if you want to create a bit more space here when the child gets older, you can drop that seat down. But it's a long time since I've pushed a pushchair. My children are a bit older. But I think generally, you tend to move away from that. As the child gets in the sort of 7-8 month category, they're wanting to look around a bit more. That's at that point, you probably switch it around anyway. And then the lady who was asking about the, you know, you can, all the adjustments on angles and heights work equally, whether it's facing forwards or out. Everyone likes to see it folding, just like folding. It will fold with the seat on or off. I find it easier to fold it with the seat off, and it's very easy to take the seat on and off. So there's a little safety button here. Just pull that, put it up. Sit quite nicely. So, sort of typical London mum pushing it home, it can just fold up and stand in the hallway, under the stairs, wherever. But you can also, when the seat's facing out, it can be folded with the seat on. On, you press down, and to take the brake off, you press down again. So you don't have to hook your toes underneath a hard piece of plastic.
And they're all magnetically fastened
as well. Just two, these things here we've just moved down, their position is in terms of height. When the carry cot's on there, you position them higher up because the carry cot has got the depth that the seat doesn't have. And then when you put the seat on, you just pop them down again. So there you've got two seats. And one of the feedback that we're getting from consumers, again, this is where baby shows are fantastic, because you can see hundreds, even thousands of people that you'd use on the seat, as well as on the carry cot. Unzip it. Just pop this handle off. And literally just opening it up. So the one thing that I'm sure some of you will have spotted, this is the one thing that you will have to store for the first 3-4 months until you stop using the carry cot. But the point is, once you finish using the carry cot, and the seat is what you use for much longer, then the carry cot can go back inside the seat, keeps it clean, keeps it stored, and then it's ready for the next occupant, which is probably going to be baby number two. See, it doesn't take very long, and bear in mind, it's not something you're going to do twice a day, it's something you're going to probably do once in the lifetime of each baby. Designed for the toddler to be on top and the baby to be on the bottom. Two good reasons for that. One is mechanical. The centre of gravity of the product is down here, and you want the weight of the toddler over the centre of gravity. It makes it safer and easier to push. And then the baby, who's the second one, he's never going to be as important as the chap on the top, the girl on the top. And that's kind of the way of the world, you know, the older one is always going to be up there on top looking out, and the middle one's going to be underneath. Again, have a quick go with that. I'm reliably informed that pushes very well for a product. Still room under there for either the carry cot, and we're just testing. It's got a nice plush. You know, it's a foot muff, but it just happens to be a very nice foot muff, and it looks lovely. It fits into the seat properly. It's got little magnets here. So again, there's all the design detail. Yeah, the magnet's there. There is a magnet. And when it's in the pushchair, it works properly. So I'll pass it around, there's a foot muff. The parasol you saw earlier, the clip comes out so that when you buy a parasol you get a clip for both the Kobi and the Xari, which kind of makes sense. And then apart from that, pretty standard parasol. Very nicely made. There's a change bag, which is one of the accessories which you can buy, which is equipped with all the usual mess bags and insulated bottle holders. And then the Kobi itself actually comes with a change bag, which is just here, and that fits down here. And then, twins, and you wanted to use the car seat and the carry cot, it makes for quite a low amount of stuff you've got to take with you. So that just pushes down, and as I say, the wheels can come out,